lambs laid naked to the heat, they carve their way through the land. To some, a desert waste of harsh reality, but to one, a place of birth, a feeling of eventuality. Mm-hmm. So then in the introduction again, I've got the photograph of Dad. And I say, for you, Dad, into the mountains you and I loved so much, thank you for sharing them with me, more than a memory, an integral part of my being. Mm-hmm. At this point, I had people in the background. Anyway, so that's I will true. Try to not no. do that.
Yeah, but it, you know what? This is from your heart.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So hiking with Dad in the Berg. Dad's gift and lasting legacy to his four children was the wonderful annual trips into the mountains called the Drakensberg, meaning Dragon Mountains in Afrikaans. My three brothers, who are a lot older than I, each had their experiences with him, hiking high up onto the peaks and along the escarpment for several days at a stretch. By the time I came along and was old enough to join them, they had left home, and so I ended up having our father all to myself as a guide into the wilderness. Mom enjoyed the mountains too. While Dad and I took off for a few hours, she would read or stroll around in the beautiful gardens of the campground and the game reserve where we stayed. I am grateful that she gave us the gift of our time together, and maybe that was her chance to relax with her own company. For the shorter walks, she would come along too, and then we would all go down to the river to take a quick dip in cold rushing waters and have a picnic. Some of my best childhood memories are walking with Dad in the foothills, or the Little Berg as they are called. We loved exploring and climbing to high points where we could sit down to rest with our legs dangling over the edge of rocky outcrops to enjoy the vast panorama around and below us. The feeling of expansive space, the room to breathe, to be, was heady and was liberating. Dad didn't talk much, except to point out vistas or animals that were of interest. He was also careful to teach me where to watch for snakes and to be observant of the changes in the weather, which had the potential to waylay the hiker in fast materializing mist or sweeping rain curtains that could crest dramatically in thrilling thunderstorms. In his own way, Dad shared his love of the mountains and nurtured my awareness to see the beauty from the small to the magnificent, to hear the silence and feel the presence of this special place. I grew to love the timeless serenity and the spirit of the Berg while watching the clouds throw their changing shadows over the craggy faces of the mighty peaks of blue. I could almost feel the waves of long yellow grass as they rippled like a giant invisible snake over the dreaming hills. My being would reach out and connect as I breathed in deeply the unique smell of Africa, the aromatic dust and grass filled with sunshine, the freshness of clean air. My ears would either sing with the lazy buzzing of the insects, hidden insects, or be soothed by the caressing whispers of wind, while the benevolent sun warmed the body into a dreamy stillness of utter contentment. Dad's parting gift to me before I emigrated was the last trip into the Berg, a poignant memory filled with twinges of yearning and nostalgia. We all knew it would be for the last time. I will always be grateful for the experience, especially now both my parents are long gone. I wrote this book as a tribute and as a form of catharsis the year my dad died. Love and sadness were expressed in words and symbolism that just poured out in a steady stream of release. I felt he was with me as I did so, and so it was that the story just came to be. It wrote itself. I like to think that my parents' spirits now roam forever free over those beloved mountains of home. One day I'll join them and we'll be all together again. Guess what? I didn't cry.
I almost did, though. That's very beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Yes, so I wrote that actually, as I say, when I was tweaking the story. That wasn't written 27 years ago, obviously. And then it goes into the fiction. So I called it subtitled to An African Legend because what it is basically is this Canadian investigative journalist / photographer. She works for a magazine that's called Explorer, which is sort of along the lines of the National Geographic. She's based in Vancouver, that's where I was living at the time. So she travels to this wild mountainous region in search of a remote African tribe with an intriguing legend. And then through a twist of fate, her life is saved by a reclusive man with a mysterious past. Lost and stranded in the wilderness, he becomes her protector, and with his guidance, she is accepted by the tribe. Dangerous encounters with gorillas, and I don't mean the animal gorillas, I mean the terrorist gorillas,
okay.
finally led to a startling conclusion, an unexpected connection to her unknown father, who was a game ranger who died in Africa doing what he loved before she was born. She always wanted to try and go to Africa to see what his life was like. Anyway, it says almost written 30 years ago, it's a novel of Africa that's fast disappearing and in some ways now only exists in precious memory. So there's an unexpected twist towards the end, and I won't say anything more. Just leave you with a little twister. And then one last thing was, when I was writing the book, as I was saying, there were some nights that I just wrote and wrote and wrote, and before I realized that it was the early hours of the morning. So this particular morning, it was morning, it was 4:30, and I suddenly looked at the clock and realized, I better go to bed. I was supposed to work later that day. And I had this very unusual, strange experience. My dad loved birds. Actually, what I'll do, I will just read it to you, and it's actually going to be in the ebook that's now being put together. So, it was my indication that Dad was giving the thumbs up for the book, because he had already passed, and somehow I knew it was him. That's my reality. My dad loved birds. He built a bird table by a grapefruit tree in the backyard and high enough that the cats couldn't get to it. His morning ritual was to put out seed and whistle for his feathered friends to come and get it. We saw a great variety while enjoying our own breakfast. When my dad died, I started writing a story as a way to release some of my grief. I would often lose track of time, which would mean I only put my light out in the early hours. A few months had passed when one morning at 4:30, I decided I needed to stop and go to bed. I was sitting at my desk, which faced the outer wall and was right under the window. I looked up, sucked in a startled breath, and froze. So it literally was this far away from me. Right in front of me, on the other side of the pane of glass, sat the biggest, most beautiful male woodpecker I had ever seen. His colors were astonishing in their vividness of red, black, and white. If the glass had not been there, I could have literally stretched out my hand and touched him. He was that close. Because he was so large, he had to sit slightly sideways on the outside window ledge, his body leaning against the glass. He had his head tipped to one side, and with his eyes steadily fixed on me, it seemed as if he was able to look right into my soul. He was so still, I almost wondered if he was alive. It was eerie, and I was mesmerized. We must have both been staring at each other for about 5 minutes. It felt like that. When suddenly the craziest notion and thought entered my head. It felt as if he was trying to speak to me. Is that you, Dad? I asked in my mind. With that, as woodpeckers will do, he made a slight skittering movement, and with the minimal amount of fuss, he just flitted off the ledge and vanished instantly into the darkness. Somehow I knew my dad had used the bird to come and tell me he was still with me. I never before or after that incident saw any woodpeckers in that place again. So I'll leave that to you for you to decide